Hey, are we recording? Recording.
Oh, not recording yet.
Good morning, welcome to the Vaughan Mall Committee, we could take the roll.
You want us to do that?
Yeah, let's just make sure everybody's here.
Well, we know you're here, Doug.
Yes.
Nancy Pearson.
Here.
Ed Reynolds.
Here.
Sam Weinbaum.
Here.
Brian Murphy.
Here.
Ellen Feinberg.
Here.
Peter Vandermark.
Here.
Okay, so review the notes for meeting minutes of the last meeting, any comments? Emily Corbett is actually Emily Corbett, B-E-T-T, Chadwick. Is there a full name now? Corbett Chadwick.
Is she a mom yet?
Yeah.
Is she?
Is she the mom? Oh, cool.
A couple of days ago.
Boy or girl?
Great.
Girl.
Girl, yeah.
Terrific.
And one more for your team.
How's everybody doing?
I guess not. I haven't heard any more.
Okay.
Deb Shag was
one more for her team.
Okay. Discussion of, so all, can I get a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Right. As amended. All right. Discussion of goals and strategies. Goals for the Vaughan Mall.
Excuse me, before we start that, I just want to remind the committee, with my apologies, that I'm going to have to be leaving the meeting early and earlier than I actually thought because the meeting I'm going to is in Dover, so I'll probably be leaving here at about 20 of 9.
Okay.
So my apologies.
Try
again.
Not to dawdle. All right, so who would like to start it off about the goals for our project here?
You kicked us off so well, Brian.
Yeah.
Well, I don't have any thoughts about specifically what the goals should be. I have some questions to ask that we can all work together on. So I'll take it back to my initial comments last week. Are we a design committee? Are we searching for solutions or possibilities for what we're doing with Vaughan Mall? Or are we setting goals and objectives for what this committee is framing to then bring in, others to define those things?
You mean like a landscape designer or whatever.
Yeah, urban designer.
Urban designer, yeah.
There are all kinds of disciplines that could bring good things to that outcome. So, and that, I think, should be part of our discussion. If others, then whom?
Yeah. I don't know. My sense is we're not so much designers as setting the goal, and then when they come back with something, we can present it and discuss it with the public and alter it if necessary. But I don't know, other people?
I just wasn't clear on when you said when they come back.
Well, when the designer comes back with something, we could say we want it to be sustainable. We could point to the things in the PS21's report saying that people liked chairs and trees, and we could make comments about the space we think are relevant. So we're sort of creating an RFP that someone would come back with a design that we could meet with the public and discuss. Another thing we could do would be to, at that point or even before, to do some sort of tactical urbanism type thing, which you say, well, we're going to try out different types of benches in different areas, or try a solution for the entrance to the Hanover. From the Hanover side, which is pretty much a concrete desert, and see if those solutions have any validity in a temporary interim type of basis, and then we could look at something. But so, Nancy,
I feel like there's an opportunity to blend the work that's already been done, which we've got two different simultaneous things that I'll talk about, and Brian's idea of sort of taking that 30,000 foot view and tackling how we want that work to be done and what kind of precedent we want to set. So we've got the plan that
that the previous committee created that I presented last week with lots of information and public input. And then we've got the PS21 report out. I think it would behoove us to sort of look and see where those dovetail. And then from there, how do we pull in some of Brian's overarching conceptual ideas for sustainability and the other things that you mentioned as a way to tackle the rest of the project as we move into Worth and Bridge Street?
Yeah, there's sort of strategy and tactics here. And if you're talking about benches, that's really tactics.
Right.
So what do you see as how Vaughan Mall would be part of an ongoing larger picture? I mean, what is it? Where do they intersect?
I guess I have another thought about this, about maybe we want to start at a higher level. Mm-hmm. About what's our overall purpose and values that we want to bring to this. So mm-hmm. Is it important that this is a connector? Is it important that this is, I want us to kind of think about, so then we could measure all of the different actions and activities against those and make sure we benchmark that, yes, let's say connectivity is a key element of this, that everything fits into that, or environmental sustainability, or whatever those turn out to, those big ideas or big underpinnings that we have, whatever word you want to use here, that we have those as our measure against which we look at strategies and goals and everything else. So I think that would help later on when people say, well, why did you do this? Mm-hmm. To say these are the things we all agreed needed.
So is principles important. A good word? Like principles
connectivity, values,
sustainability,
whatever.
Attractiveness, I don't know.
I'd add it's a wonderful opportunity for calm on the way between busy, relatively sterile new construction, hotels, and the historic downtown. So it's can be a calming place too, sort of a.
So that's sort of a value.
A value for me. And all the others that were just mentioned, connectivity, sustainability, and then the other word I wrote down was that one value is sort of a more practical one, is it has to be thought of and integrated with some of the other plans, you know, that are worthwhile.
Yeah. So on the higher level that we're talking about here, I think there was a sense sort of general agreement we want to be some sort of sustainable, more green, more softer place than it is now, is sort of a general goal we would probably all agree on. So I thought Ellen's point about is it a place or is it a pathway is a good question.
Yeah.
I mean, at the long-term things, probably it's sort of in between. In the short run, it might be good to make it more of a place. With movable chairs, that could be, you know, more of a walkway later on.
How would you define the difference between those two? I mean, how is that different from any urban street that we have? I mean, Market Square is a place people talk about, but it's also something that connects, you know, has various means of transportation that flow through it. So I just wanted to know how you see those two as either different or related or.
Yeah, I guess it would be the, to the extent that you emphasize the throughway, you know, I mean, is it a path? Or is it, you know, a lot of stopping places and side rooms along the way?
I think it's both. Yeah. I mean, isn't it both? It's certainly, we've talked about it as the connector from, you know, the African American burial ground all the way to the North End. It certainly is that corridor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I
but
think
it's also a place. I think Sam
Yeah, I think so.
It's got a few places.
I think it's important to keep in mind that for anybody who lives on either end of that north-south trajectory, it is a pathway. I mean, I personally, that's my pathway from where I live to go to 3S or anything on that side of town, typically on a bicycle, which I don't even know if that's allowed in Vaughan Mall, I do, you know. So, and if I don't have that as an opportunity, then that puts me out on Maplewood, which I don't want to be on Maplewood on my bicycle.
So it's got to be a fairly substantial pathway going through there.
That's personally how I use it, and I can't imagine I'm alone, because where else are you going to go to get from south to north or north to south?
There's certainly enough width there to maybe accommodate both, because, I mean, it must be 30, 40 feet wide of...
It's a standard street, I think.
Width-wise.
But that's interesting, the multimodal...
Yeah.
What didn't come up, I don't remember that coming up in any of the PS21 discussions, but that's another...
Mm-hmm.
And that Fleet Street isn't going to change much. Maplewood may, but I think it's just going to be more narrower with the parking, that's important.
Mm-hmm.
It's supposed to be a complete street.
Bike lanes go on to Maplewood, this might not be, I mean, I think that's definitely something to look at holistically, you know, because it could change people's habits.
Maplewood. Yeah, I think, though, that it's good that there are always alternate routes, you know, like the more little streets you have in the downtown crossing makes the network improves. Right?
Sure.
We could do both.
Stop in at the works on our way if it's hot. There's already habits that are forming, you know.
Yeah. The quickest way, through the new thing, by the music hall and then the African burial ground, it's also sort of the most direct way to the pond, the school, tennis courts. So
yeah.
Well, the city explicitly put a lot of effort into that Rockingham apartments block to make that lovely path between the African burial ground and the music hall.
So, right, and
absolutely,
Sam, you're so right. Like, let's remember that the North Mill Pond will be a waterfront park. 3S is putting outdoor artwork in. So that path isn't even going to stop at Portwalk. You know, it's going to go all the way to Vaughan Street, all the way to the North Mill Pond. So,
So, in terms of overarching goals, I mean, you also have Jeff Speck's four rules or whatever they were. One was it needs to be comfortable. Needs to be interesting and safe, and I forget what the fourth one was, but interesting, safe, comfortable, but those could along with sustainable, if comfortable might mean chairs or greenery, interesting might mean artwork.
Interesting could be the way it's planted, the way it's lit, the way it's the facades of buildings, you know, variety. It's not uniform. I mean, it's not now, but I think for me, that's something I would like to preserve. I don't want it to turn into a kind of...
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Mall-like, you know, every facade would have the same appearance. I don't think there's any... danger, quote unquote, of that, but I think that's something that makes it interesting.
Yeah.
And is part of what urban fabric is about, as opposed to, in many cases, suburban, which is designed to be more uniform in shopping areas, for instance.
Yeah. So this may be getting into tactics, but I think of the mall as like three sort of separate rooms. There's the Hanover End out in front of Cabot House. There's the middle section, the stage and the trees, and then there's the third section next to. It sort of naturally breaks up because of the way the buildings go there. So maybe looking at the design, there might be possible to sort of keep those as, or emphasize or expand on that sort of natural division.
And that would feed in or fit into the what might happen in the work slot, the middle room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No. So sustainable. So we all agree on sustainable. Do we want to? You want to say interesting, comfortable? Yes.
This is that word.
Yeah. Can we stop and play and
sure.
explore what we mean by that? Like in my mind, I don't know if other. I'm thinking, you know, water collection gardens. Thinking.
Yeah.
Ways, opportunities to capture rain. Like that's what I'm thinking. I don't know what other people are thinking. Like visible, maybe even artistic opportunities to do those things. But I don't know what that means to other people. I think we should explore what that means in our minds.
Other people?
Well, that brings up what Brian said last time about making it an example or something that could teach. And the art, I mean, I don't know how many people have been to the High Line, but that's a work of art, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's demonstrates a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah. Are you referring to, is that Lower Manhattan?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've not been. I've seen pictures, read articles.
Well, somebody, I think Doug pointed out when we were doing it, that Vaughan Mall is exactly the width of the High Line.
High Line?
Yeah, so when you think about what they've done there and the possibilities.
Yeah, yeah, that was Robert White pointed that out.
I think part of that could be how would you say, illustrated or explained features that potentially homeowners can apply to their own property. So we put a swale next to the street in Rye for the stormwater. We're the only ones that we know of in the whole town that did it. It's magnificent. Didn't cost much of anything. And it captures the rainwater from the street because everybody above us basically, you know, has nothing. So, and it also captures our driveway. So they both go in. And we mention it, we show it, and it's kind of lost, even though continued new places that get built, you know, they're trying hard to capture the rainwater, but you know, nothing really. So if it could also be, a part of it could be, well, so the public can see how it can be done, right? Like no water came from anywhere other than this concrete or, you know, the building. I think that would be really cool. And the plants do super well. You don't have to do a thing.
Yeah.
So I wrote down improved stormwater management supporting more vegetation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
Almost a haiku.
And you know, they could be,
calm.
You know, what plants were used, you know,
yeah.
why, you know. Could be a whole teaching,
so
teaching thing too.
Educational could be an
mm-hmm. educational.
Yeah. So stormwater management. I know part of the PS20 thing was native plants that don't require a particular amount of water that are suited to this environment.
Hey, maybe the EPA could give us a grant. Give the city a grant. After all these millions and millions of dollars for drains, for something other than drains.
Yeah. Well, they are very, it's very important that the city address stormwater, and there's a whole section of the public works now, which is meeting new federal requirements about stormwater.
Yeah.
So,
but in a way other than the usual, maybe there's some opportunities.
Well, this will be the come the usual,
Let's
I think.
Let's not forget that we have an EPA dissent.
Yeah.
Consent decree.
Yeah.
That includes this area.
Oh.
That's in 20.
Yeah, by the end of before 2023,
okay.
has to be done. So,
we shouldn't be doing things that will get undone, or we should incorporate these ideas in the design, which is where it is right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So,
or Fleet Street, you mean? Or
Fleet Street
utilities, but
it includes. It's Peter Rice said, I believe, last time
last
that
time,
this is part of that design.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to try to do stuff that's, you know, not going to be torn up.
Right, right.
They go in and work on those utilities in a year or two.
Right.
Or a couple years.
No,
or
instead.
Or we have it as a value or a goal that gets incorporated into that. So
yeah.
That we're not,
enough.
So that we're.
Let's have things we do here feed into that plan and get funded. Because there's funding behind that plan. Right?
Mm. The money.
Well, speaking of money,
I think we take advantage of loans that are available But Peter would be the one to answer that question.
I also wanted to say sustainable could mean economically sustainable, so we want to create an environment there that makes, I know that we've seen turnover in the retail. I can't speak for what's above the street level because I'm not I'm not privy to that, but I know we keep seeing turnover, so I think that's something that would be important to figure out how we can help make this give this a different kind of footprint. It has a, it takes on the place that people want to be because it's a great little area that is really got the kind of vibe that they want to move their store to and keep it there. So, and that we get the kind of traffic they need to be able to keep their business rolling. So I just think that we might want to look at that part as well.
Yeah.
I think that's a good point. I mean, you know, sustainability is such a buzzword these days, and whenever it means different things to different people. And whenever I think about it, I go back to, you know, 1987 Brundtland Commission for the United Nations, Our Common Future, and they kind of coined the term and defined it, you know, how do we meet our needs today without sacrificing the ability of future generations to meet their needs? And they look at it as three pillars of economics, environment, and social. So it's kind of almost like a Venn diagram. And in the middle of all three of those, that's where you get true sustainability. So it's kind of balancing all three of those. And there's an opportunity in Vaughan Mall where there's, you know, social aspects, economic, and you know, obviously urban, environmental.
I think this conversation is just peeling back the surface of what sustainability means. We kind of stopped short when we said capture rainwater or plant nice plants. I think that's starting to point toward the foundation of sustainability, and it's thinking of things as a system. As you know, the things we introduce here are a system, and they're part of a greater system. And so it's great to capture the rainwater and feed the plants in that place, but how does that connect to the larger system around it? It'd be great to capture solar energy and power the lights that might light this place, but how does that connect to a larger system in our downtown urban environment or in the world? And I think that this points to I think the opportunity for, and I'd like to continue to advocate for, considering engaging professional designers that can bring that knowledge of systems to this opportunity, and really, and when that greater understanding of the system emerges and what we want out of it and how we want it to plug in, and that emerges, then we'll find all these wonderful opportunities for where is this cool bench or this neat lighting installation. You know, then it makes all of these things more meaningful when they're part of that system.
So are you saying that we should have someone come in and work with us, or that we should set up the goals and hire somebody through RFP to come up with a design that they would come back with, and we would say, yes, that's what we want, no, that's wrong, or we want more of this, or something like that?
Yes, I think all of that, or some other possibilities. I think it's something we need to discuss and determine what's most appropriate for this work. You know, an RFP process is great and often necessary in a municipal setting using public funds. And it's often, in fact, required to have an RFP process. On the other hand, it might be nice to just interview and find the right fit that understands, because sometimes RFP processes don't allow for that element. It's sometimes just a low bid. Not saying that that's what this would be, but you know, again, what I'm saying is there are pros and cons to all approaches. So I think we just need to discuss what's most important, or you know, what's most appropriate for this process. But I think the sooner we have this engagement, the more we can be educated, and it can shape our conversation and help define the goals. And you know, we were talking a few moments ago about public engagement in this, and we've had some. And where does that fit into this process? You know, sometimes public engagement can be a process of hearing everybody before the parameters are set, and then as the parameters emerge for what we're out to do, sometimes all the public input doesn't really plug in so neatly, and some of it unintentionally falls off to the side, and then we have hard feelings. Public input and engagement could also be an opportunity to educate and give parameters, define parameters, and then take input with those parameters being understood. So I think that's also something we need to consider in this process.
So can I just kind of interpret what you said, what I hear you say? And you know, I think we've done both of those mechanisms. Let's take some of our park projects, for example, where if it's a neighborhood park, we'll hire a landscape architect, and we will bring that group in, and then we will have a local meeting. What do you like about this park? What don't you like about this park? Get the feedback. Then they go back and come back with a plan that gets a reaction. I'll call it a reaction or further feedback.
Yeah.
And then we move on from there. You know, then we've also done something where let's say a group like this might have specific goals for an area, so you put that out, whether it could be an RFQ. So to your idea of whether we interview someone ahead of time, but we could maybe invite qualifications, but put in that the principles, ideals, the kinds of things you're talking about. And then what I'm really hearing is that maybe this exercise becomes the pilot. Vaughan Mall becomes the pilot for that, for use in other placemaking things, like areas in the city.
Yeah.
For example, you know, maybe along the North Mill Pond, where we're working now with designers on that bike ped path with, you know, some hubs along it, that type of thing. So am I hearing that right, that this committee could maybe set some parameters that is used? Not that it has to be followed exactly in other places, but the principles of the sustainability and looking at how we use benches and plants and stormwater management, that type of thing, because every area is unique. Is that kind of what you're saying?
Yes, I think that's what you're saying is accurate, whether or not it's exactly what I was saying. But yes, that's part of what I was saying, that this... where I have said that this could be an opportunity to test how we do this stuff. We're always doing that, right? No matter how we go about it, these endeavors involve two things, among others, but two predominant things that are involved here are people and change. And those are two things that are hard to fit together. And so we're always learning how to go through this process of planning change, and how do we engage the community so that we have the best outcomes, and you know.
So Ned,
well, first I have a question, but then I wanted to make a statement. I forget from last meeting. Does this committee have a budget of $10,000 or something to hire the services?
Well, this
or is there a little
a certain amount of money has been set aside for capital improvement. It's in the capital improvement budget.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So there are some funds that were set aside for implementation of this strategy.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
And
right.
The
yeah.
thing that has initiated is the concert in the Worth lot, where I think I can't remember what the dollar amount is. I can look it up. It's in my file.
Yeah.
But those are for like the demonstration projects that that strategy suggests.
Okay, so that's great. Yeah,
but if you're going to do capital things, you know, actual infrastructure type of things, we would have to submit something, as we talked about at the last meeting, in conjunction with the capital planning schedule, which would mean something this fall.
I was first just asking about did we have funds to hire, say, an urban designer with an RFQ, and et cetera.
Yeah,
But the other thing I was going to, I guess two things I wanted to
add. I think there was a discussion that there might be some money that could be found to do a small amount of.
Yeah, okay.
That's implementation, I think, of that, because it's professional services. It's not a bricks and mortar, you know, project. What would follow from that would be a bricks and mortar.
So, but I know we talked last time about how, as far as like, I mean, I'm all for public input. But there's been all the public input into this, and there's been lots of public input, the PS21 process that Emily told us about. So I'm not sure that we need to, I didn't see this group as being a vehicle that would conduct a whole another bunch of public input process. I mean, it seems to me we have the mandate and a lot of input already to, and we've reached out and brought in members of the public, you know, good people, smart people, been here a long time, to do something. Like, I mean, I don't know if we have to overthink it. It's make some physical infrastructure and, you know, environmental enhancements to Vaughan Mall that make it a more attractive, you know, and do that in a sustainable way. So increase the economic vibrancy, you know.
Yep.
Let's not keep looking at our navels. Like.
So I agree with that a little bit in that I reread PS21's report from Emily, and it's very thorough and has a lot of, what was most popular, lights, movable chairs, native plantings, new planters. So, and my initial thought was that we would have a public meeting, get input, but it may be get a plan and then get public feedback on the what was based on this and the other plan and go from there rather than, you know, have a more involved step like
this. I mean, my vote would be that this is the group that takes all the input that's been done already and actually.
Yeah, I think at some point you have to show it to the public and get a reaction to
it.
But maybe not initially.
Not initially.
But they're invited.
Yes.
Give them something to react to, like you say.
Promote it a bit more and say show, great.
Yeah, definitely.
Give them some excitement.
Peter?
I'd just like to ask Brian if you could give us some examples of, I mean, we're not just talking about a landscape architect or somebody, we're talking about somebody who looks at the systems. Can you, I mean, that's not part of my world. Give me some examples of people that might work that way and how they work.
Sure, yeah, there are environmental planners and water conservation specialists, and you know, there are all kinds of people that work on the scientific level about these things, but connect that to the planning and design of the built environment. Mm-hmm. So they carry different titles, but there's overlap, and often they flock together, and so you can find them in one house, you know, one firm.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What I find interesting is was it Steve Whitman?
Steve Whitman.
I don't want to give any plug, but that was an incredible effort in, you know, for the PS21 and the report with Emily and you, Doug, involved. That was incredible. That was sort of the surface kind of thing, but in detail. And then the big report on the Worth lot and all the bridge, that I found also was a surface kind of grand scale, but with less, much from what I could, maybe I'm wrong, but more about the flow of people and the activating spaces and less about deep view of or look at sustainability, calm, you know, it was sort of the grand scale of designing a whole neighborhood. Then there's a third, so that was wonderful. The PS21 was kind of the detail, but what's lacking, and I think is going to be huge here, is there also has to be a real deep look, I'll call it the system, but everything that's underneath all those places, because it's amazingly complex. Mm-hmm. And anything we do or propose that's of a longer has to be consideration of that. It's huge.
Are you talking about the underground engineering? You mean the
underground engineering of the whole area.
permitting at UJ.
And he makes such a great point, Sam, and also the plans that are already in the capital improvement plan surrounding this area, like Maplewood and Fleet Street and all of that. So it's definitely part of a bigger system in so many ways. So, you know, the more we can tie into things already being done. And I will say, though, to your point about public input, yes, we've done a lot, but memories are short, and there is absolutely, and not just in Portsmouth, but in general across the board, when it's new to you, it's new, even though if somebody's been working on it for 2 years. And I think we need to bring people with us the whole time. So, you know, all opportunities to bring more people on board, I think, are good opportunities.
I just want to say one thing. I think the one kind of value or overarching piece we haven't talked about is the arts. And I just want to make sure that we keep that on the table, mm-hmm. because Absolutely. So much of, I mean, the music hall, this beautiful sculptural and landscape tribute to the, you know, that's the burial ground, and also whatever else is going to be, you know, the connector to 3S. So I think we have to look at where that fits into this piece as well.
Absolutely.
And unfortunately with that, I have to leave. But I think one of the public things we can do is figure out along the way if there's a series of articles in the paper, even though I know everybody says they don't read the paper. Somehow when things are in the Herald, people all know about it. So so I think
they filter out through Facebook and things like that.
So there might be ways to, without having to do a huge convening, to get the word out about where things are going along the way and invite people's input, whether however that can happen. So excuse me. I look forward to being at the entire meeting next time.
Do you, the next meeting, do you have any concerns, preferences about the date time?
Are we going to be all doing this right at the moment? But I don't, I can't.
All right.
Can't respond to that, sorry.
Okay, it's all right.
I mean, would we like to keep it at this time on a Friday?
That would be,
This is usually fine for me.
Okay, that's.
Bye, Ellen.
Bye, Ellen.
So, I lost my train of thought when she got up to leave. So if we were going to, so in regard to what both Ned and Nancy said, do we want to imagine what an RFQ would involve and then present it to the public, or do we want to somehow publicize our ideas and get a reaction to it and then go for something like an RFQ?
My instinct is telling me that not enough people know that this project exists, that work has gone into it, that the public has weighed in, and I think any opportunity to catch people up is something we should consider.
Go ahead, Peter.
Well, I was just going to say, for me, it's frustrating to not know the timelines of any of these things. I'm wondering if we could somehow nail down what we know, which is that 2025, is that, what is that?
23?
I think 2023.
The underground work,
Early 20s.
I would add to that that I think we should, in addition to taking time to finding all of the known things that are out there, round them up and look at them together, I think we should also spend a little more time with each other. You know, we started down a good road here at the top of the meeting talking about what values. If we took a little time and dumped out all of the values that we all bring to this conversation and, you know, maybe have those rolled up together, those with all of the known facts and you know, efforts that are going on around this, and there are probably a few other things that would go with all of that that would be very helpful in an RFQ or RFP process, or, you know, however we go about it, engaging others to plan and design. I think all of this stuff would be really helpful.
Okay, so let's put that on hold for a second. Let's talk about a timeline first here. So, I mean, that's sort of concrete, and we know that if there's going to be a capital request, it's got to be by October, right?
Correct.
And there is also there's an RFP for the Fleet Street project currently out there. Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. When is that coming in? And
I think it's in July. It's due. The proposals are due back.
And does that affect what we might do, or it's too late for us to put any input into that? It's already out there.
That's to hire someone to do the design for the utility work.
Which includes Vaughan Mond.
It's called the Fleet Street project, but
what's it include?
So that's
That's what's going to be determined by the designer.
Right. The basic area includes Vaughan Mall because of the utilities, but the project's really about Fleet Street. The RFP, is it an RFP or RFQ?
I think it's an RFP, but it's on the city website.
It says the consultant shall lead public meetings for residents along Fleet Street and businesses along Fleet Street. The initial meeting will identify concerns and a plan of existing conditions and recommended proposed changes will be presented at that initial meeting.
So that's just Fleet Street.
But as Peter Rice said, the utilities connect into Vaughan Mall.
So if you dig up Vaughan Mall, it may not affect Fleet Street, but the assumption would be that you're just doing the underground, so it doesn't really affect Fleet Street unless we get involved.
It's
right?
A system, though. I mean, you have to remember that yeah. It will affect. I'm going to read from Peter Rice's email back to you, Doug, when you ask about it. And he said, at this time, we're looking to select a design firm. The details of the scope of work will be negotiated once the firm is selected. As you may recall, the Fleet Street project is primarily a utilities project. However, we anticipate various tasks associated with streetscape will be included. The scale of the streetscape improvement will be determined during the design process. It will depend on the available funding. So I think that there's definitely a need for this group to participate in.
Does it involve the Vaughan Mall?
Right. Is it the streetscape of Fleet Street, which is really lacking? The sidewalks are really crappy and everything,
just Fleet
right?
Street.
That's part of the scope to be negotiated once the
Oh, it may well because he's got to do Vaughan Mall too.
But it's a whole.
So, but Vaughan Mall is
different. It's a different one.
Well, Vaughan Mall is you have to dig it up to work on the utilities, so that might be an opportunity to work on the streetscape. Or
I'm just trying to determine if this Fleet Street thing is just Fleet Street, or is it going to involve the whole kind of loop there?
I don't think there's anyone that can answer that, because that's what the design firm is going to
So they'll look and say, hey, if we do this, we absolutely have to do this. Okay, got it. Okay. Yep.
I'm still throwing my brow on that one, because I mean, I get that the pipes and the wires are interconnected underground, but a design firm that's thinking about the streetscape of Fleet Street, that's a complete block over from
I think the design firm is thinking about the utilities. But because you're digging up the street, it's going to include streetscapes. Once after you dig up the ground,
On Fleet Street.
No, why don't we come back at our next meeting with the correct response to all of this.
Okay. Yeah, that's
fine. I know what the question is, but
it's a whole block of buildings in between Fleet Street and Vaughan Mall.
Let me tell you, it's complicated.
Peter Rice indicated it's not unlike Islington Street. What's going to happen?
I'll just throw out what happened yesterday. Both buildings, the Franklin block and my building, need new transformers. Neither transformer can be in the alley. It's shared in the little alley.
Good luck with that.
Okay.
But to Brian's point, it's a system, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is the kind of stuff we're talking about.
Okay, so getting back to timeline.
Yeah. So if we were going to make input on that project, we would want to have when will that project start, possibly?
Well, the RFPs are due next month. And then there's going to be the process of reviewing the RFPs and selecting the design firm. So I imagine after the design firm is selected and they have a contract.
Mm-hmm. So,
but we don't know yet what they're going to propose in terms of where and how much.
That's
you're saying?
Part of the scope to
yep.
be negotiated.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, so we have the October thing. So if we're looking at an RFP or an RFQ for what we want, that the RFQ we could do on our own right away. The RFP would require a capital budget request, right? Is that right?
Yeah.
Possible.
Yeah, I mean, if you're talking utilities, infrastructure.
Yeah,
no,
I think we're
capital,
talking about
capital
a lot
budget.
Of long-term vision for the area. And do we want to consider changing the charge of this committee? Because our charge is to develop a near-term action plan.
Mm-hmm.
So do we want to focus on doing something that we can try out now before the utility project happens? Or do we want to focus on something that we can do after the utility project is done and redesign the streetscape?
Yeah. Well, it seems like if you're going to do something sustainable, you need to remove some of the cement so you can have more plants and stormwater runoff management and that sort of thing. So that may not be involve entirely the underground utilities, but
yeah. But I think our charge was to stay above ground.
Mm-hmm.
So that we're not, when it comes time to do this Fleet Street and associated work, we're not re-spending money digging things up again.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't, I mean, to what you were talking about at the beginning of the meeting, it doesn't preclude us from looking at models going forward that could be used elsewhere. And when the time is appropriate for going subsurface here,
right.
You know, implementing some of that, those principles.
Are raised planters, raised beds, you know, people do raised bed gardening in their yard.
Mm-hmm.
Could we, as an interim step, could a landscape architect advise us? You know, there's also that sort of vertical gardening, you know, aquaculture, right? Would it be possible for us to do some above ground softening of the landscape?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's it's important to mention that because it's kind of diving into a detail, but I just want to make sure our thinking isn't limited by thinking we must dig into the ground to be sustainable. I don't think that that's necessarily the case. There, we can plant things, as Ned just said, we can plant things in, you know, vessels above the surface.
Right. Mm-hmm. Planters, large planters.
And there are so many different ways to do that,
right.
And those things can be made so that they're helping manage
climbing vines, right? Climbing flowers. You can do a lot of vegetation that doesn't.
I would think the key focus area, maybe for short term, would be the jungle, the concrete jungle on the other end by Hanover Street, because that's really nice stuff has been done in the middle. And, you know, it's okay, but that area there.
Concrete desert, as he said,
the
right?
Desert,
by
and yeah,
by the La Carreta,
yeah. I was walking by there the other day, and I noticed, you know, there's the planters in the middle, and it's just kind of mulch right now.
Yeah.
It's really
so
amazing.
I think
a nice garden or flowers there would look beautiful.
I think we're diving into solutions, and we're kind of getting ahead of ourselves. I think to kind of back up and talk about the things that are defining the what solutions we need might be helpful. I don't know how much time we have left in this meeting, but if we
half hour max, I would say. Yeah.
Would this be a good time to talk again about the what's important to bring to this effort? What sort of things would we like to see? Not ground lights or jungle gyms, but what are the kinds of the bigger things. What's
values
this?
And principles.
The purpose of principles.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Could I read my bulleted list?
Yes.
I've been taking notes. I'll just take 20 seconds. Sustainability, integrated, connectivity, attractive, pathway,
calm, comfortable, interesting, safe, educational, systemic, artistic. And then I had a few arrows that were linking some of those words, because some of those are connected, like artistic, interesting, attractive, right?
Should we write them on the board?
So yeah, I mean, I could write them on the board. I could put them in the minutes.
You better do this, because my handwriting.
Well, I'm a terrible speller. I apologize in advance.
So all right, sustainability or sustainable. Integrated. Connectivity, connected, pathway, calm, comfortable, interesting, safe, educational, systemic, artistic.
Anybody else?
Spelled everything correctly.
Peter looked up the four things that you were trying to remember, and they were a reason to be there, safety, comfort, and interest.
So we have a reason to be there, which
is... So a lot of those are in there already.
Do we want to add... we have safe.
Yeah, so we have a reason to be there, which is it is a pathway between the music hall and other areas. And
people
and
go there to listen to the music, too. I mean, yeah, we've got lots of concerts planned there.
Where they set, I hope, and eat lunch.
Yeah, so for a walk, Jeff Speck's saying there are reasons that make people want to walk.
Can we add?
And
yes,
that,
yes,
can I
right.
add the word destination? Right, because we have pathway. I think it's both. It's both a
People have lunch. They have a coffee.
It's certainly a pathway, but we also want it to be a destination.
I got another one. Shade. It's one of the, is it the only place downtown?
Not a lot of shady spots you can sit out.
Other than the alleys, shade.
There's commerce there too.
Yeah. Well, that
Should I write that?
Well, somebody's point was economic.
Economic development.
Businesses would love it if you put that in there.
Vital, maybe? Make or vit, you know, something like vitality? I don't know.
So let's try to group these a little bit here. I would say that connectivity and pathway are kind of the same thing, right? Calm and comfy are sort of the same thing. Maybe safe also. Not quite, but... I don't know what you mean by systemic.
Well, I was going to Brian's, I think I wrote that when he was talking, you know, about it's a part of a system, right? It's a part of the downtown system.
Mm-hmm.
It's a hub, if you, you know.
So really. That's sort of connectivity and pathway then also? Is that right?
I mean, sure. I think it goes more to,
pathway.
I think it's, I guess so.
I interpret it more as part of its surroundings.
Think about how it relates to its surroundings. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I would add maybe the connectivity and pathway gateway. It's definitely a gateway between two distinct parts of the city.
It's kind of
or transition.
Transition
gateway.
Kind of transition from
it's a transition,
view.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Transitional zone.
So these are.
So. And interesting and
artistic certainly,
and maybe educational would be all related.
I skipped over attractive was a word I had, but you know,
it's got to be, goes without saying.
This is probably going to give some people heart palpitations. Sorry about that.
This is one of those charts where you end up.
I take a picture before we erase.
I mean, it's not that we have to, you know. Categorizer. That's like yes. These are all things that we want, right?
Yeah.
Is this making anybody think of other words that need to be up here?
The pets.
Animal.
Well, that's, because there are a lot of apartments and people. Everybody.
That's kind of a tactic, and I started thinking along this.
Yeah.
But it's important. It seemed to be
Welcoming.
Very important to people. You know.
to people, the pets.
Dog bathroom? No, thank you.
So what kind of value is that? Is that a welcoming value? Is that an inclusivity?
It's kind of a destination.
Okay.
Yeah, no thanks.
Yeah.
Dog bathroom?
Well,
I own a dog and a cat, but I don't think the public should create places for
but
me
it's
to
also
go.
Well, they're already allowed there, so
I know,
it's not like we're going to kick them out. I mean,
so that's, yeah, sort of comfortable, maybe.
Can I honestly put the word welcoming?
Sure.
And I'm going to slash inclusive because we also always want to think about all the different modes of transportation that people require and need to get to a place.
It's important.
Mm-hmm. Which we can. Okay. Sorry, but that speaks to safety.
I'll add a couple of words that are probably squarely overlapping with some of this, but maybe just add a little definition. I think, first of all, it should be unique, and all of these things we're talking about are pointing toward that, but I think we should keep that at the fore, that this is uniquely Portsmouth. It's not something you'll find, so we're not taking off-the-shelf things and that you'll find in any other town. This is something that we create. It's our town. It's our space. We've touched on this, and maybe we've said it clearly, but I'll say it again. I think it needs to be a place. It needs to be in places. Many things happen in places, and vibrant places have lots of things that happen there. Maybe not simultaneously, but there's opportunities for lots of things to happen there. And then that points toward the way I'm thinking of it. Being inclusive, yes, it has to be accessible. You have to be able to get there and be comfortable there. But what does comfort mean, and how does that apply to different people? Hopefully, it's a place where anybody, no matter what they look like or feel like or how they identify, they feel welcome in this place. It's a challenge. I do this in my work every day. How do we make the built environment do that? I don't have the answer yet, but I'd like to keep that as part of the conversation. Art, it's been mentioned, art. I'd like to just say a few words that it's not just a sculpture here or a mural there. How can the place itself be art? How can it be artful and engaging and stimulating? I do not have the answer for that either, but I think the answer for that is broad and possibilities are as well. And then a couple of things that haven't been mentioned, particular elements of engagement and a sense of play, a play space in the downtown. Now, on the surface, one's mind might leap right to like a jungle gym for kids, and that's not necessarily what we need. That would be great. I think it would be awesome to have a place downtown for little kids, because you see them get dragged around all the time because their parents want to go to downtown for brunch or whatever. But where is there a place for kids and a place where kids can be and be comfortable and feel included, and also families can be there too? Like, it's not parents waiting around while their kids get their fill of playing. Like, the parents could be there too, playing or eating or doing whatever. Or anybody, people who don't have kids, who want to be around kids. And, I think there's a tremendous opportunity for that kind of engagement here. That's all I got.
So I just have thought, and then another way to think of this is, what is Vaughan Mall being successfully used for now? I mean, like, you have this thing in business, like, if you want to get more customers, what you do is the first place you can look is the customers you already have and try to build on that rather than go out and find a whole new group that might be interested in. So to me, you have a lot of people taking breaks there from where they're working. and you have people going there for lunch and sort of an open space where they can hang out at lunch and eat outside and that sort of thing. So to the extent that can be enhanced, that will make it more comfortable and interesting, and it's that sort of getting into the placemaking aspect of that. You know, who you're trying to appeal to. Children, yes, but that's kind of a whole, I'm totally in favor of that someplace downtown. I'm not sure Vaughan Mall would be it unless it's people coming from the hotel areas going to the African Burying Ground and stopping along the way. Nancy?
So...
Peter was...
I'm sorry. Peter was ahead.
Well, sorry, but take you back up 30,000 feet. I mean, I'm just afraid we're maybe reinventing, or somebody else is going to have to reinvent it after us. Because when is this beautiful plan of Worth and Bridge Street going to take place? Because we're going to... all of the things we're mentioning are also going to take place there. Mm. We spend a lot of effort trying to put them all in here. Mm. You know,
that wouldn't be very systemic, would it?
The whole picture, you know. So, do we have any sense of that? I mean, is that 10 years? Is that...
when we created the committee, we were sort of looking out pretty far.
Yeah.
We kind of wanted to put the stake in the ground, plant the stake in the ground as the north end and the northwest end continued to fill in.
Yeah.
And as I said last week, this is city-owned property, so we wanted to make sure people knew that the long-term vision was to carve out a space always and forever, that there wouldn't be like huge buildings on it.
Yeah.
But we don't have a deadline. There's nothing in any capital improvement plan except for the funds set aside to...
it's like $25,000 a year, sort of planning money.
In my mind, I was always looking at this as something to think about when we have broken ground on the Mac, if and when we ever break ground on the McIntyre. That's my mind, is... that's when we start thinking about something like this, just because so many projects at once can be a little overwhelming. But, you know, Doug brought this forward, I think rightly so, because why not get all the systems going at the same time? So the answer is, I don't know about the bigger plan, but you're right, a lot of these things are going to be integrated into the grassy area of the Bridge Street lot, you know, all of that eventually should come online.
Mm. Well, I mean, when I look at it, I thought that also one of the thoughts was that was going to be a route into the city for people from the new parking garage, mm-hmm. you know, and mm-hmm. like, for instance, this isn't, I guess, in our charge, but that parking lot, Worth lot right now, people are always walking down where the cars are. They're in the traffic way.
Yeah.
There's a lot of space there. I mean, I don't know whether it would be possible to just give a little more space in the middle, shorten up the sides, and have a pathway through there. But even that kind of thing, how this traffic's going to flow, is going to determine how we do the Vaughan Mall. So I just think it's such a big...
mm-hmm.
Yeah. Could we do that? Could we...
Yeah, I think it's getting a little outside of our charge to start. I mean, I think that it might be possible to do something right next to the Vaughan Mall, like food trucks in the next to the brick wall there. But going further than that, I think would be more ambitious than our charge is at the moment.
So it sounds as if we could, with a design firm, I mean, come up and work with whatever's the engineering plans that are going on, come up with something that could be done in 2 or 3 years.
Sure.
Or we could do a whole bunch of these little, you know, plop.
Yeah, I'm in favor of the short run.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it would be great if I think it should integrate with what's going on, but the PS21 spent $5,000 and made a big improvement. I think if you spend a little bit more money, mm-hmm. make the lights more permanent, get better plannings, do that sort of thing, and have a kind of a design to the thing rather than just sort of putting stuff on top, that you can really make a big difference in the comfort and interest and, you know, attractiveness of that spot.
And it shouldn't maybe exclude the idea of lifting up some of that cement.
No.
Because it's going to have to come
to
out
me,
anyway.
I just wanted to go back to one point, this sense of play point, because in all of our public spaces in the downtown, the Vaughan Mall is the only one that is vehicle free. Even access vehicles are not on the Vaughan Mall. So if you were going to have any destination in the downtown that spoke to children and families specifically, I think Vaughan Mall is a natural place because children can free range, if you will, at least within the confines of that area, knowing that there will not be a vehicle except maybe a bicyclist.
Sure.
If you think of
a rogue bicyclist.
Boston Common and the duckling statues.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's like the ultimate thing for kids.
Yeah.
And it's not a jungle gym.
And all they want to do is just go sit on it.
Sit on, you know.
And their parents want to take pictures.
Some things of that sort could.
Prescott Park Whale.
Can I throw out an idea somewhere?
Yeah.
Can you get a mic?
Yeah, so kind of building on that and trying to pull in all these different ideas, I don't want to get too deep. I think we're having a great discussion on the big picture of purpose, and I don't want to get too deep in ideas, but this is just giving the idea to, you know, maybe make it welcoming and play and artistic and stuff. How's the committee feel about maybe some sort of artistic temporary mural on the ground and maybe a life-size checkerboard that, you know, kids can play with or hopscotch and stuff painting there? Because that's something that we can do near term, temporary. You know, people can go play with. I've been in Switzerland, and in a park there's life-size checker or chess that you can move around.
I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know how much longer we're going here, but I wanted to follow on that. I've been sitting here, things running through my mind. I want to make a suggestion just for consideration, a potential element of next meeting. And I would volunteer to coordinate this. I know I have on my phone and in my head, and like Jake just mentioned the thing, everybody's been places and knows of things that they think are really cool, like either a sculpture or a play feature or a fountain or a growth. What if we did a mini Pichakicha where everybody contributed 10 pictures that we could show for 10 seconds each at the next meeting? That's a minute and 40 per person. And I would volunteer if people wanted to, you know, email me your pictures and I'll put them all into a PowerPoint and we could just have people, you know, here's Brian's 10 pictures and he says, oh, this is there, this is this thing here. I mean, I've been in the Seaport District. It happened to just have occasion to go there a couple of times. And so I posted that on Facebook, the Lawn on D. And that's what they've got, like life-size chess thing. You know, that people are, they got ping pong tables, like hardscaped kind of ping pong tables, people playing ping pong. But it's like, it's a hard table, you know, it's not obviously a residential table, but it's like a weatherproof ping pong. And you know, you can check out the paddles and like, how cool is that? Like if you had people doing that on, so just like if we could just share our ideas, it's like we can talk, you know, but a picture say 1,000 words. I don't know.
I would fully support that idea for the sake of, you know, we throw words on the wall and everybody has a different interpretation or definition for that word. And so without diving into detailed ideas, we can look at precedent for things that are actually happening in other places and that have been done.
And so, Peter. Well, in the presentation you gave us, there were a lot of those examples.
Like everybody could bring the things they think are cool.
So it would be good to relate these to the words on the wall so that we start to fill out this as not, you know, getting our goals as we were talking about when we started here, because not just tactics, you know, ducks or whatever, but, you know, as it relates to what we're trying to achieve. We're sort of floundering about for a direction here, but so maybe we just have to flounder for a while. But I think we want to try and relate it to our goals so we can give something to somebody and say, come back with a design at some point.
Yeah.
Nancy? I just caution that we don't backslide, and some of the good work that we've done in this area that has precedent photos.
Sure.
That Vaughan Worth report does. I know we've just spent a lot of time in the McIntyre where there's a ton of precedent photos of all of these kinds of placemaking.
So can you send where those are specifically?
Yeah, I can send the links to that. This was done by actually the same consultant that...
I found their work on sort of the grand, how would you say, grand scale as opposed to the intimate scale. Mm-hmm. And I'm after hearing everybody and also seeing what's in vision, that this area should be maybe a more intimate, playful, sustainable, but also kind of modular space so that things can come in and out and change, be it artists or it's more intimate because it's between the buildings, it has the trees. It'll be a long time when all that's built for that to feel the same way. That's going to kind of be the grand... grand space.
And earlier I had the word versatile came to my mind.
Versatile.
Because I was thinking sort of seasonally, it certainly changes as what kind of a place it is or could be.
Yeah.
And
really
then also day and night, right? Day and night is two different things down there, right?
All right, I added two words. Take
versatile
your pictures over
and
again.
Modular.
Did I learn?
That's
one?
Okay.
Versatile.
How is it? A?
Versatile.
I think
there's
an A.
T-I-L-E.
I'll send, can send these to you. Well, we can send a list out.
Yeah.
Takes a village.
I got to get that one.
To get me to spell
correctly.
Awesome.
Okay.
So, and I urge people to review Emily's report on PS21 because, you know, it says what elements were most important, light, string lights, movable seats, native plantings, new planters, improved stage. And then dog amenities, that sort of thing. So there's a list of things in there that furniture was the most popular part of the whole project. And so there's some good information there that would inform some of these questions here. Okay, so do we want to try and do the pictures around these elements? And
so my question, I guess, would be, have we answered the question, are we short-term, or back on short-term now? So our pictures should be easy-peasy, light and breezy.
I don't know what that means, but it sounds great.
If it's going to be modular, if it could be modular and versatile, we can try things now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go
like
to the future.
Like painting,
where it's,
like
you know,
painting
done,
concrete.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Okay. Got it.
All right. So lean towards that, and in terms of plantings, sort of above the ground plantings.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah.
Short term.
And it's unclear to me, there may be areas of Vaughan Mall that are not just utilities immediately under the surface. It was suggested the PS21 thing by Robert White that you could just cut up some of the cement. You might find dirt underneath it where you would be able to.
Well, where there's
use
a vestige of colored concrete there.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That was cut up in 2002. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that area, when you enter from...
Congress, right?
No, that's from the Worth lot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So these pictures...
It's not very colorful anymore.
I was told by Eversource this week and that the sewer and water pipes are much, much deeper than any electrical would be in that area. So... there isn't much electrical, I don't think. They didn't say there was any.
Well, we'll have
other
to.
Than the, so there could be the potential to, in certain areas, to
put dirt or have dirt.
Yeah, but it's not much electrical. I don't know how deep the gas is. I think 3 feet.
Yeah.
But you guys would, because there's a new gas line through there. So I think there's the potential to.
Yeah.
So many hard.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, in terms of
on the worst parade mall, R.I.P.
Oh yeah, old Portsmouth. And I'll send out. I can send out a link, but one thing people might look at would be the NACTO stormwater guide for streets, National Association of Transportation County Fish, something like NACTO.
State and Highway Transportation Officials.
So they have a stormwater guide for streets, which shows a lot of the sustainable things. Vomo isn't a street, but it might give you some ideas about swales and whatever.
Yeah, there's definitely some greenery to play.
So, okay, so next time we will have some pictures. Maybe we can send them to Ned.
Yeah, I'll come up with a mechanism. I'll work with, I don't know, maybe through Jake or just go to Alan Brady, or maybe we can have like a Dropbox or something like that. We'll figure it out.
I find the Google photo albums are really good because they're much easier to do a slideshow than any of the Apple or any of the rest of them.
Oh, yeah?
Oh,
you just
gosh,
push
yes.
the button and they start playing.
Yeah. And so we're going to organize it around, try to organize it around our goals.
Right.
And we're looking more short term than long term. So something very built, like in front of the music hall, might not be appropriate in the short run.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Anything else we should say? Okay, so our next meeting, 2 weeks on a Friday?
So what would
I'm not sure what day that would be. 3 weeks on a Friday, 2 weeks on a Friday.
Let me look.
It's the 12th.
Okay.
Is that EDC or no?
No. Wait.
What?
EDC is the 19th, right?
The 12th. Doug, I do. 2 weeks is the 12th.
The 12th works for me.
3 weeks is the 19th.
I can't do the 9th. I'm gone for a couple weeks after the
19th. The 19th?
19th. I'm leaving the...
So
that's
2 weeks is room. July 12th. I mean,
so we can try July 12th. Does that work for everybody?
Works for me.
Mm-hmm.
Do we want to say 8 o'clock again? Okay, 8 o'clock on July 12th, and we'll see what people come up with. Peter?
Well, I just realized that... I mean, I'm kind of seeing that this is a short-term thing, but how do we keep in mind some of the things that we come up with might be something that would be good for the long term? I mean, I'm mm-hmm. assuming that somebody's going to design this whole thing again, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, it's not
it's
just
a
bridge. And it's a okay, well, yeah. it's all going to be rethought.
Yeah.
But speaking to what Brian's brought forward is how are we going to categorize or remember
mm-hmm.
some of these things that we would like to see in the final plan?
Yeah.
Or should we just forget that? Should we just say our job right now is to find some stuff that's going to make this work for the next, I'd like to know how many years, you know,
mm-hmm.
3 years?
Well, they may not be contradictory, you know. I mean, just like PS21's lights and stuff sort of inform what we're doing now.
Yeah.
I think what we do now can inform what works more in the long term, maybe another step okay. in the direction of something permanent.
Yeah, that helps me.
I also yeah. think like we evolve and learn as a community. So when our master plan, whatever we want to call that, design plan, we weren't really going down the road of sustainability and those principles weren't really at the forefront, but now they're integrated into everything we do. So my feeling would be when this Blue Ribbon Committee sunsets, we take the goals, the principles, and all of that and gift it to that committee so that they live and can be integrated into the next iteration of that project.
Yeah.
Sure. Like that.
Yep. Okay. So I guess a motion to adjourn?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, we'll see you in 2 weeks.